So fundamentally what I'm doing is I have a data set like so. And in the simplest case, in the simple train test split, commonly what I do is I leave 30% out for test, and I leave 70% in for train.
Bootstrap does something interesting, and it was sort of a controversial technique, but what Bootstrap does is, so let's say that this is the data set, this is the original data set. What Bootstrap is really doing is trying to solve the problem of, it's trying to gain, ideally we'd like to have a classification, a cross-validation technique that's as robust as leave-one-out cross-validation without the computational complexity of leave-one-out cross-validation. Leave-one-out cross-validation is complex because it needs to run, and same goes for n-fold cross-validation. Whenever I increase n, I'm increasing the number of trials I need to do, that I need to run in order to do that cross-validation. And so it basically scales linearly with, the amount of time it takes scales linearly with how I choose n. Bootstrap does something interesting. It says, what Bootstrap does is it samples from the data set. So let's say my data set has, again, consists of a number of rows. And so it will sample, this is my Bootstrap data set. And I have n rows, in my sample. N items. And I randomly sample, randomly pluck n items. So I sample this one, sample this one, sample this one. And I do this sample n times. And it's interesting, right? Because if I have a large data set, that means I'm going to sample some twice. By happenstance, I'll happen to sample some twice. Right? So, you know, by the time I get down here, if n is large, or even if n is small, you know, I might sort of pick one here. But really the redeeming factor, the reason why I can do this, and really the benefit I should say first, is that This is my training data. Is that my training data is 100%. I'll say n train equals n. Let's say n items. So in other words, there's 100% of my. I retain 100% of my data set. And so I do this once and again. Let's say we'll sort of enumerate this as A, B, C, and we'll say that this is, you know, G or whatever. Whatever, I guess, maybe this is C, whatever. So I get A, B, and then, I'll sample G here, right? So I get G here, and then maybe I also get G down here. But I'm gonna get everything in between. So I'm gonna get maybe a Z here, right? So Z, I'm just resampling. It's like picking marbles from a jar. I'm picking a marble from the jar and I'm putting it back, shaking the jar, picking another marble, and I get a training data set that's probably not going to, it's going to have some missing values. And I do this, I repeat this process, the sampling process, multiple times. We'll say, because every single time I'm going to be getting some items twice. But if I'm sampling correctly, then there isn't a preference for any one of those items. There's no bias towards any particular item. I don't know if I have room here. Can you guys on the left, can you guys see this side of the board?
Okay.
Oh, this is the bootstrap. So I sample from X. And times with replacement. That's the key. With replacement. So, I mean, obviously, if I didn't do it with replacement, then I would just have a shuffled version of my original data set. So, sampling with replacement. We'll call this sort of transformed data set X bootstrap. So my bootstrap data has the same number of items, as the original. So I should say, I guess, the length so I have 100% retained. And then that's really it. And then I fit the model. And then I repeat. And just like how in full cross-validation, how I took an average, I'm taking an average in bootstrap data set as well. Very similar to N-fold cross-validation, but really I'm sampling with replacement. And it gives me 100% of my original data set. Okay, so these are really fundamentally, aside from simple cross-validation, these are really fundamentally the three major cross-validation techniques you'll see. N-fold cross-validation, leave-one-out cross-validation, which again is just really just a type of N-fold cross-validation, and you will see the bootstrap cross-validation, which in principle is somewhat similar. The only difference with N-fold cross-validation between bootstrap and N-fold cross-validation is that I am I'm sampling with replacement in the case of bootstrap. And if I do the bootstrap enough times, I'll draw an arrow back so indicate that I'm sort of repeating. If I do this enough times, then because I'm not biasing when I take a random sample, I'll get a reasonable average. Okay. So pre-model workflow, linear regression. Linear regression within sort of this matrix of learners, we have four different types. Regression is really interesting because there's all sorts of different tools we use for classification, right? So for classification, there's support vector machines, we talked about decision trees, we talked about k-nearest neighbors, we talked about logistic regression. And what's interesting is that you know, these are all very, very different strategies, very, very different algorithms. So KNN is very, very different than logistic regression, right? So logistic regression is, KNN is very different from logistic regression, which is very, very different from decision trees. And it turns out that in theory, most of these classification problems, like k-nearest neighbors, can be adapted to be regression problems. But regression problems are more or less, I guess I should say, homogeneous. There's less diversity in approaches for regression algorithms. And I guess theorists may disagree with that, but in practice, regression is typically fitting polynomials to data, right? So there's sort of two strategies within that. We only talked about linear regression. By the way, I just want to clarify this point. Fitting polynomials is still linear regression. When I'm fitting a polynomial, when I'm fitting a quadratic or whatever, or a cubic to a set of data points, it's still considered linear regression. Linear means that the parameters that I'm finding for the regression are linear, they're first order. So, linear regression. Supervised, continuous. So when we're trying to predict a continuous value, this is when we use linear regression. And sort of a simple case where we have a set of data points. And really, let's say I have x1, x2, and I can sort of think of x1, x2 as sort of a big table, right? So x1, x2 form a set of coordinate pairs. So for instance, x1, if this is x1, sorry, I'll just say I equals 1. Okay, so this is my index. So I have some index here. We'll say it starts at 1. And this is some small value, maybe 3, 2. And each one of these points, so really my table here, my data frame, all my data frame, again, see this. So the simplest, so my model, what's the, I guess the degree of the model, I guess we'll take one step back for a second. What, in all of them, all of these tools that we've used, every single one of these learners that we've used, regression, classification, clustering, dimension reduction, there's always been some features, some parameters of our model that aren't determined by the learning algorithm, right? So in the case of KNN, right? So with k-nearest neighbors, k is what we call a free parameter. It's not something that's deduced or derived by our model. In linear regression, I guess to sort of
at a high level, there's two parameters that,
at a high level, that we use to sort of tune our data set, or really, I guess I should say, to tune our model such that we find the best fit. Yasir, what are common parameters that we use with regression? Well, let me think about it. So with regression, there's a few different things that we can sort of modify, right?
So if I told you this, so let's say my data set looks like this. I'll plot a few more points to make it more visible for those in the back. Larger. Maybe my data set looks something like this. Nothing more than a set of points and two dimensions. And my objective, really, the fundamental objective is if it's a line that best say fits the data. So that predictions can be made. I'll use a new acronym here, OOS data samples. You see this acronym a lot sometimes. OOS just means out of sample. Out of sample. Which means what? Generalization. So in other words, this is what I know, and maybe tomorrow I would see a point. Points that are not in my training set are out of sample points, right? So, you know, I might see it tomorrow, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. We call this out of sample data points, points that are not in the training set. So how do we do this? I mean, I guess really I guess there's sort of two different, or there's a few different approaches we can have. We can have the parameters are, well, first of all, the order of the polynomial. Sometimes you see this written as k. But you know, this can be some binary number, integer. So this is basically a line, right? So this would be order one, right? So just a line. When k is 1, the order of our polynomial is 1, and so it's just a line. When k is 2, this is what's called a quadratic. The function is called a quadratic. The actual shape of the curve is called a parabola. And if k equals 2, if the order of our polynomial equals 2, it's going to look something like this, right? And you can imagine, I won't plot each of these, but eventually we're going to get over here somewhere where we're getting very, very high values. And we can sort of arbitrarily increase the order of our polynomial. Again, we can sort of play God with this algorithm and say we want to make the order of the polynomial 100. Just for the sake of example, let's make the order of the polynomial 100. And so what happens is that when we make the order of the polynomial 100, we're left with a curve that looks sort of, might look something like this. This is k equals 100. Terrible model. Terrible model. Fantastic fit on the training set. And so, really, as we go from left to right here, this is increasing complexity. We're increasing complexity. The simplest, unless we're just taking a basic average or a point, the simplest polynomial we can have is a line, a quadratic, and a cubic, et cetera, et cetera. And eventually, you know, we can, you know, if this is our entire universe, then we could just fit a very, very high polynomial with marginal error. And so what happens here is that, what ends up happening is that we're overfitting. We're increasing complexity.
And we're getting a great fit.
But we're not getting a fit that models reality. Our model is divorced from reality because it's too complicated.
And it's too closely married to the training data on which it's modeled.
It's sort of like
when you don't study for an exam, and so the day before the exam, you study and memorize the study guide. So you perfectly know the study guide. You don't know anything about the subject at all, but you know if you got that study guide, it could be quantum mechanics or whatever. You know all the answers to that study guide. But then you get the test the next day and the questions are completely different. So you've done extremely well on training, but when it comes to any realistic evaluation, you're hopeless. And we described another term. Unfortunately, there are a lot of different terms for these things. I don't know why statisticians and mathematicians are always coming up with new terms for this stuff. But we also call overfitting high variance, right? So this is the danger zone of high variance. And that means, it's just a synonym for overfitting. And it's called high variance because the model might get lucky, it might not. You know, it's going to be all over the board. Some data sets, it'll be close, it'll coincidentally, sort of, these points will closely align with the model. And so you're going to see wide swings in the accuracy of the data with respect to what we call out-of-sample data, generalization data. And so it's going to be all over the board. On the other hand, in this example, we might say a quadratic, eventually, if we get our model's too simple, we call this high bias. And again, high bias means that our model is always off, but at least it's off consistently by about the same amount, right? So, you know, if I plot a straight line through this data, it's going to more or less give the most rough approximation of the data it can. And so it's systematically inaccurate. It's always off. At least it's sort of consistently off. Call this high bias. Okay, so again, one degree of freedom of our model is the order of the polynomial. We have the order of the polynomial. So we need a way, it'd be great if we had a way to sort of find what the best value of k is. So we can find k I'll ask you guys sort of obvious question, but how do we find k? So k isn't given to us. We don't know k beforehand. And at least the problem that is presented so far does not
tell us
what we should choose for k. So how do we find k? Nathan, how do we find k? Think about it. Okay, that's fine. Answer how we find k, and I'll come back to you in, I don't know, 5 minutes or so. We don't know k.
There's another, we didn't talk about this in tremendous detail when we went over
regression.
But there's also a parameter that we have that's called a regularization parameter. And in scikit-learn, I think it's called C. In some other cases, it's called
lambda. Give me one sec to pull up the documentation. So, okay, within the linear regression function, there's a few parameters we can choose. It's within the cross-validation model, but you'll see sometimes...
what we call a regularization parameter lambda. And again, given the scope that we have to cover in this class today, I won't cover this in detail because the math is a bit deep. But the regularization parameter it's sometimes called lambda. It's typically within math notation, it's called lambda. Within scikit-learn, it's C, which is 1 over lambda. So it's represented for C, which is 1 over lambda. And again, the regularization parameter determines how much cost is imposed on high order or high degree of the increasing degree of polynomial. In other words, remember we talked about R squared, and we're ultimately trying to find the line of best fit. And R squared was really a function of how close this line approximates the data is defined by some of these residuals. What the regularization parameter does is it will increase the cost. It will adjust the R squared value accordingly. It'll sort of decrease the R squared value as we increase the complexity of our model. Sometimes you see this as being called a cost function. And this is called a regularization parameter. And a high lambda yields less overfit. High lambda means less overfitting. Since C is 1 over lambda, less overfit, I should say, that bias. Conversely, a high C, just to clarify before, this means that a high lambda, when you set a high lambda, your learner or your model will bias towards simplicity. This is another way of saying bias towards simplicity. So, a high variance model is just a fancy pedantic way of saying
an overly complicated model.
So my k equals 100 line here is a very, very complex model. That's my high variance model. All over the place, does well sometimes, does terribly the next. My my straight line is my high bias model. It's my overly simplistic model. Always wrong, but wrong at least by the same amount consistently. Sort of think of it like throwing darts at a dartboard. Like if I'm always throwing, if I'm very, very accurate, very, very precise, you know, but I'm sort of 30 degrees off, I'm always going to throw the darts at the same, they're always going to land in the same spot, but always block the same amount. On the other hand, if I'm just throwing darts randomly, you can imagine when throwing darts randomly, sometimes I might get close, sometimes I might be off completely. And so that's high variance. And again, just to sort of establish nomenclature, high lambda is will cause a simpler model. A high C, which is just 1/λ. C is 1/λ. A high C. Will give a, typically give a high variance model. We call this the bias variance trade-off. A very, very important concept. Everything that we do within machine learning is trying to find the sweet spot between the high bias and the high variance. Trying to find that Goldilocks zone where we're not too simple, we're not too complex, we're just right. Yes, it's also on support vector machines. So in other words, it's a great question. So we'll have time for this in just a sec, but if you set a very, very high C, it means that you're not penalizing your model for being too complex. So logistic regression, you can imagine that logistic regression is looking for a boundary. Logistic regression is in principle very much related to linear regression. The principal difference, I guess, from an application standpoint, is that logistic regression is a classifier, fundamentally. It's building a separation boundary. Linear regression is finding the line of best fit. It's almost sort of like, you know, in the high variance case, playing connect the dots, but it's trying to find really a function, a continuous function, a polynomial that best fits the data. Logistic regression, you can imagine, I sort of drew in my previous example over there. Let's say we have a logistic function that looks something like this, right? Sort of like my high variance model. And you know, on one side of this boundary, so this is my training data set, right? My in sample data. And again, just on the training sample, I have something that's very, very complex. And let's say my other class, my secondary class, my false values are on the other side. And so I've done very well in training data. But you can imagine that as soon as I have to generalize, as soon as I need to extrapolate these concepts, as soon as I start generalizing, well, then I'm going to start seeing x's here, right? Because it's just my model model is lucky, and so it's not going to generalize well. And yes, on logistic regression and on support vector machines and several of the models, you'll see the C parameter. You'll see the C parameter on a variety of these models within scikit-learn. I think I'll just send this link on Slack. Can you apply which?
Absolutely, yeah. So I mean, that's it's mathematically and principally the same. So in other words, really what it's doing is we talk about cost. We talk about really machine learning is really all about objectively minimizing a variety of costs. We're trying to find sort of our best middle ground between competing costs. And what regularization is doing is it's introducing an additional cost for high complexity. It's saying that just like how we can think about being far away from, you know, where our data is. So when I move the line down or up or left or right, it's going to increase the cost of the model. So it's a less optimal model. And you know, we can think of that parameter as we can think of that same concept as being used with regularization, where regularization is just increasing the cost with increasing complexity. So if you look at like SV support vector machines, which is unfortunately named SVC in scikit-learn, there's the penalty parameter C is really the regularization parameter. So a high C will give you more complex topology, more complex models. A low value of C will give you high bias, simpler models. All right, awesome. This is a good spot to take a break, and then we'll sort of spend the second half of class really recapping, I guess, going into more efficient methods of optimization, pipelining, classification, and evaluation. So I'll see you. Yeah, let's try to all be back by 8:05.
Thank you.
In the lectures folder for this lecture, you'll find classexercise.py, which I guess, which has really most of the content for the rest, the second half of the class. Most of the content here is familiar stuff, but there's some important new concepts that we'll get to in just a bit. The data set, the first data set we'll be looking at is the Titanic data set. You'll want to download this Python file and just open it up in a text editor, whatever text editor you prefer. And also start up your IPython notebooks. We'll sort of be building up this IPython notebook from this Python file from scratch. I'll give you guys a couple minutes. So I guess I'll do the same thing, so we can all be on the same page. So I'm just navigating to the DAT20 folder, my Python notebook. Let's start by creating a new notebook in Advanced SKLearn. Actually, you guys can create it wherever. I'm going to create it here just so I can send it out to the class. Don't commit this to the repo. There's no reason to commit any of this. Just yet. You'll notice also that the CSV files use absolute paths from the web, so you should be able to run this code anywhere. If you can't, or if you can't load any of these files or run any issues, again, just reach out to Josh or DeepT, and that way we don't have to spend class time doing it. Okay, so. Let's sort of put an objective on the board. How do we find the best parameters? Right, there's all sorts of different things we can use. We have lambda, we have C. This is kind of hard to read from the back. We have lambda, we have C. We don't know beforehand, and there isn't any closed form analytic way to solve for what the best value of lambda or the best value of C or K in the case of K-nearest neighbors or the depth of our decision tree in the case of decision trees, or what we want to give word weightings in naive Bayes, et cetera, et cetera. So how do we find the best parameters for a model? And we've talked so far informally. What we've really done is iterate. Over a large range of values and find the best one that works.
And I guess we'll also call this more or less a brute force approach. It's not very elegant. It's slow, it's ugly, it's cumbersome, but
in most practical aspects, it works, right? So I guess last week, last Tuesday, we talked about k-means clustering, right? How do we choose k for k-means clustering? Some values of k work better than others. Same thing with KNN, same thing with all of these parameters. Some values are crap, some values are good. And sometimes we have to iterate over a large range of values in order to find one that works well. Sometimes we have elegant and clever ways of doing that. Other times we just sort of have to bite the bullet and do an exhaustive approach. And we call this grid search. And you can imagine, so for instance, you can imagine sort of revisiting my regression example here. So this is the polynomial order. And I call it k. And I guess we showed sort of a toy example of 1, 2, and then we took it up to 100. And let's say that this is my out of sample error. Right, my generalization error. Sometimes we call it out of sample error, my generalization error. How well I did, I guess let's sort of think about two ways. How I did within my data set and outside my data set. So say around here, around one, let's say this is, for simplicity, we'll use r squared here, and we'll say that this is an r squared of 1. So maybe 0.5 is here. And so 1 doesn't do bad. And maybe it gets like 0.6 or so. 2 does even better. It goes up to here. And I'm saying, my assumption is that this more or less resembles a line to me. So we'll say after, as we go to higher order polynomials, eventually what happens is my error rate starts, my accuracy, my R squared, starts going down on the out of sample. And so, you know, really, this is my sweet spot. And this is really what grid search is doing, is it's basically looking at, you sort of think of these as being like a grid, right? So this is a one-dimensional case. And let's say we had two parameters, or really a multitude of parameters we're looking over. And so we can think of this as sort of like being a grid that we're sort of iterating over. To find the best possible value. So maybe here I'm increasing k. Ugh. And maybe here I'm
tuning some other parameter, like maybe increasing C. And you know, I could sort of extend this to arbitrary number of dimensions. And so I'm really filling in the gaps here, and each one of these is a score. So like maybe each one of these cells has, let's just say, score, score one, score two, etc. And so I want to find, you know, maybe which value of k, so maybe k equals one, so k equals two, let's say k equals 100. K is polynomial order. So I want to find the value of k that, and maybe the value of c that best optimizes my score, my out-of-sample score. And that's really the fundamental principle about good search. It's not terribly complicated. It's a brute force approach. So it's inelegant, but you know, it's also simple. So I'll paste this. This is go ahead and paste this first section into into a new IPython notebook. Those in the back, can you read okay or larger? Good? Okay. All right. So here we have the usual suspects, import pandas as PD, read CV, and we're just doing basic transformation. This is all stuff that's familiar. One thing I just want to clarify, I've shown this before in class, but just to sort of highlight, this map function is really sort of a find and replace, so to speak. You can think of the data frame as being an array of hash objects. And so the map, what map is doing is it's just replacing values that are female with zero and male with one. Oftentimes, it's easier and more convenient to deal with numerical data than categorical data. So, for instance, I can take an average, right? I can't take an average of male or female, but I can take an average of 0 to 1. And so, if I took an average, if you know I had variables that were between 0 and 1, and I took an average and I saw 0.5, that means I would have an equal proportion of male to female. One note I will make here, in addition, sort of going back to the beginning of lecture. This is a familiar data set to us, so we've seen this before, but we would want to explore the data set first. And really answer the following questions. Where are the missing values? Outliers. Do any data points not make sense, such as formatting, etc.? And we'll also put sort of visualization, which might be anything between scatter plots. Scatter plots don't work well for the Titanic dataset because discrete values, so it's don't quite look as good, but we can still use histograms, correlation maps, etc. So usually, I mean, these are really the tools that we've worked with, that we're familiar with in working with any data set, not just the Titanic data set. But you know, this is sort of the first go-to place because there's not much time. There's very little. The time investment here is minimal in comparison to the amount of time, the potential gain we may have in the long run. Phil and A also mentioned before, but really this is also just another type of find and replace. It's just doing what is the function as you might expect. It's just filling basically not a number attributes with the mean value. So this is called imputation.
filling in basically gaps in the data. Gaps, basically, makes sense. There isn't a hard and fast rule of when it's appropriate to do this or not. There are certain, when we're filling with the mean, we're assuming that you know, the data, there's certain assumptions we're making. This is a trade. So this is sometimes there's certain aspects of data science that are procedural, that are, you know, have theory, that have like sound basis behind them. There are also times where it's sort of, I don't know, almost more of an art than science, if you could call it that. So really what I'm doing here is I am filling, there are some missing values in Titanic data set, and those missing values exist on the page. And if you remember when we went over this data set in the previous lecture, I think there were over 100 values for age that are missing. So in other words, I'm just sort of shoehorning the mean. I'm just filling the NAs with the mean, and there may be costs of doing that. This is something that would warrant double checking. You'd want to sort of cross-validate and double check your results here to make sure that you didn't have wild differences in your data when you're filling the mean. Artificially. Really what I'm doing is I'm creating data that doesn't exist. So we'll come back to this in a second. Do it with and without. So look at the evaluation score. Yeah, so in other words, if I remove this step, Titanic dot drop NA, you know, and I did in place true, what would be the difference between this approach and this approach? And it's not obvious to me, you know, what the difference would be. The drawback to doing this approach is that I'm throwing away information. So this throws away information, right? Because I'm dropping any rows that are missing. I only have 891 observations in this data. I'm throwing away about 130 of them that have NAs. So I'm getting rid of, just by dropping NAs, I'm getting rid of almost 20% of my data, about 20% of my data. And the reason why I'm doing a fill NA here is because I don't want to discard features on rows those rows, even though some rows are missing age, there may be some interesting information in those rows that would otherwise be discarded if I just did a drop NA. pd.getDummies, again, we've seen this before in a very different form. pd.getDummies is functionally equivalent to one-hot encoding. So it's built into pandas, and we covered this. I'll split here and just sort of show you guys how this works. So pd.getDummies, if I just look at this, take the indexing off, comment this out, paste this down here. Just one hot encoding. So I'm just transforming. In fact, I prefer pandas is a little bit simpler than one hot encoding is a little simpler with pandas than it is with scikit-learn. Again, functionally, they're the same. There's no difference in the outcome between them. They do the same thing. I just find pandas to be a little bit simpler. So, sort of drill down a little bit. Titanic.embarked is a categorical variable, right? So there's three values, unique values. Said value counts. So there's three types of categorical values that I have here, and one-hot encoding is just I'm just extracting that with the get dummies. And, oh, another important thing is I'm adding a prefix here, another reason to use pandas over scikit-learn. I'm just adding the prefix to the column, the marked. So, it's just a reference so that, you know, anyone who is passing could read this column and make sense of it. It's being explicit that it's a one-hot encoding, or at least alludes to the fact that it's a one-hot encoding. And I'm using the indexing function iloc, which means index location. Again, I'll let you guys read the documentation on iloc. I know we've covered it before, and some of you also have brought it up and used it in your lessons. But really, this is saying is give me all rows with the first through last columns. And since it's zero index, it's basically giving me it's dropping the zeroth column. So saying it's equivalent to saying give me the last columns. If I put a zero here, right? So let's say I put a zero there, then I get all of them. If I put the one here, it's saying one till the end. This sort of fancy Python syntax, just saying one until the end, two until the end, and since it's three, then just it gives me really the rest of my data set. So I'm transforming my data set. And so I'm still in the pre-model workflow. And I'll bring back the original here. This is just for documentation. And let's look at the, let's break this down step by step. So we have a bunch of feature columns. We have some columns are meaningful, some columns are not, like anything else. So I'm just saying, just intuitively, looking at the data set, I'll sort of just print out the titanic.columns here. And let's see what columns we want, what columns we don't want. So these sort of have arcane names. I believe it's like number of siblings aboard, person's name. The person's name is probably not going to have. I just want to at least remove columns that I wouldn't expect to have, reasonably expect to have any outcome on the outcome, or sorry, on the predictive value. So person's name, I can drop that. I'm not interested in the person's name. In fact, in most data sets you'll see in real life, anything that's personally identifiable, like a name or an email, et cetera, will be dropped from the data before analysis for privacy reasons and also to make it just simpler to process. And so I'm just really just cherry picking the columns that I want to analyze, the class, the sex, the age, and where they embarked from. And again, just to explain this embarked variable, there's three parts of England where they embarked from. There's QS and one other. I don't know what they stand for, but they're the three locations in which they embarked from on the Titanic. And one of them I think is noise, so it was dropped. Okay, so let's try using decision trees. We used logistic regression last time. And we'll import grid search CV from scikit-learn, right? So this is sort of the star of the show. This is the first one we haven't seen yet. Everything here is so far is familiar. So I build a simple classifier with max depth of 2, right? So max depth is a free parameter. It's a parameter I have to tune. It's a knob I have to tune, and I want to find the best value for that knob. And so a max depth of 2 just means that the tree itself has a limit. Scikit-learn will impose a limit, at least one of the options for decision trees. Is how deep I want my tree to go. And so you can imagine that maybe there's some ideal length of the tree, or maybe not ideal, but optimal. So
I have a tree that looks like this. This tree is a depth of 2, obviously. Depth equals 2. And, you know, you can imagine that I can, there's no theoretical limits at how complex I want to make this tree. The number of tiers that I want to, this tree to have. But as I do that, as I increase the complexity of my tree, again, we're sort of back at the start where we're increasing the complexity of our model, so we might see a sweet spot. We don't know yet, but there might be some optimal value for the depth of our tree. You know, maybe 2 is too simple, maybe 100 is too complex.
Let's see. So again, I'm just building a classifier. I'm explicitly setting a random state here so that we all get the same result. Cross-val score. This is really doing the n-fold cross-validation that we talked about earlier in this lecture and earlier in class. And we're saying that we want to, for the scoring metric, we're using the receiver operating characteristic area under the curve, which we talked about 4 lectures ago. Higher, so ROC in scikit-learn, this number will be between 0 and 1, 1 being a perfect score, 0 being basically doing as poor as it possibly could do. So take the cross-validation score, and let's take the mean, and let's see what we get for, sort of split this into our different groups. I'm pressing Control-Shift-Tab. I'm pressing Control-Shift-Dash-Hyphen on Mac. I'm not sure if it's the same on Windows, but I can split this by just doing Control-Shift, just FYI. Okay, so with the depth of 2, we get 80, we get an area under the curve score of about 0.80. And as I recall, I don't recall the exact score, but when we first went over this, I think the baseline score for area of the, under the curve is about 75. No, actually, I think it's higher. It's about 80. So we have a very, very simple decision tree. And concretely, what this decision tree is saying, it's a depth of 2. It's a simple tree. The fact that we have this is a reasonably good score for such a simple tree. So we have a tree that looks something like this. It has a rule at its root, and it has sort of 2 subrules beneath it. Again, the depth of 2. And so maybe, again, I'm hypothesizing here, I don't want to delve too deep into this one subject, but you know, maybe it looks something like this. If there is a passenger female, yes, no, and are they, we'll say, upper class? We learned that the 2 largest predictors of whether or not you would survive the Titanic was your gender and your class. And maybe it looks something like this, where it's yes, no, and so like maybe here I say survived, here I say survived. Here I say survived. And here it is perished.
So by applying simple rules, I can get
relatively far on this example. Let's try it with a max depth of 3. Do we do better or do we do worse? And we do better. In fact, by a meaningful amount.
So you know, maybe this gives me an AUC score 0.80, and when we go to depth of 3, it's probably using other rules like age.
So I think the largest 3 predictors are sex, class, gender, class, and age. And so when we go to max depth of 3, when we have a tree that's only depth of 2, we have less
utility
in what features we can use. Which is just necessarily a consequence of the fact that we have a simple tree. When we have a more complex tree, we can obviously use more features, but we also introduce the possibility of overfitting. So with a score, with a depth of 3, we get a cross-validation score of 84%. Cool. So let's sort of see how we can optimize this. How can we you know, break this down? How can we sort of streamline this process? So let's declare the classifier again, just as we've done before. And this is just a simple array. Range is just, it's going all the way to 20. In fact, I think it starts at 0, but whatever. So we're defining the range, defining a dictionary that defines the maximum depth of our tree. So we want to find what's the best size of our tree? The question we're trying to answer is, no good. The
question we're trying to answer is, what is the optimal depth of our tree? You know, is it something like this? Is it something like this? So we have 2. Three. Don't draw too many. Four and 7.
So let's brute force it. So PramGrid, look into this in a bit more detail, just to sort of make it explicit. It's just a simple dictionary where I have a parameter. My dictionary, this is just a dictionary. By dictionary, I mean it's a mapping of key, it's an association, like a dictionary, between what we call keys and values, max depth, and just a range of values. And so this are the values that I'm trying to optimize for. And so this is max depth of 2, et cetera, et cetera. And so I've declared the actual literal name of the parameter I'm optimizing for, and its range of values here. Okay, merge these back together. And so what grid search is doing is the signature of the constructor of this constructor method, constructor function in Python, is it takes the classifier, or the classifier takes the parameter grid. And number of cross validations, and the scoring algorithm, right? So we saw this before. We were using receiver operating characteristic area under the curve. I'm going to link the. I'll link this on Slack. It's always worth reading the documentation for this stuff. Okay, great. So what we've done is that we've taken our original classifier and it's sort of our original classifier on crack. Applying the classifier that we've declared here, our tree classifier, and it's fitting that classifier by injecting this max depth parameter into our classifier, and it's doing that in conjunction with cross validation 10 times. So that's the tenfold cross validation that we saw earlier. And so we'll really get two things here. We'll get a variety of scores and a variety of parameters. So I guess the output.
The output is, say, a collection of parameters and a collection of scores. Try not to be too hard. Right, so for each parameter, there's a score. So there's a bijective mapping between them. In other words, they're one for one. For each parameter, there's a score, vice versa.
OK, so let's go back here. Let's grab the next, sort of see what that looks like. So again, I have best estimator. I can apply multiple estimators in grid search. I can find the best score, the best param. So if I look at grid scores, print grid scores. And I think it's scores. Yeah, grid scores. We'll plot this in a second. So I have here, this is the output of my scores, right? So here's my k equals 2, the 80% I got. Here is k equals 3, that 84% we got just a second ago. Let's plot it. Let's sort of see what it looks like. Well, you'll need to call a matplotlib inline in order to get it to plot within within your notebook. Interesting. And so
here are my values of k increasing. here are my scores. And so, doing well, sweet spot here seems to be within the context of the max, the optimal max depth, seems to be about 3, 4, 5, or 6. And then it decreases. Nathan, why is our grid score decreasing with increasing K? The what? Too many clusters. No. Why is, well, what clusters are you referring to? All right, we'll come back to it in a bit. So, kind of resembles this, right? Look familiar? So we have sort of this optimal score here. And so we do grid.best score, best params. I'll just print this. My best score was 86%. My best param, my optimal value for my tree was a max depth of 10. So it's, wait, that's not right. I don't know, it should be saying 6. So there's some it could be a latent variable in my environment. So the best value for my best K is 6. My best score I get is about 86% for AOC. So let's look at the next example. How might we apply this, you know, in conjunction with some of these sort of transformation tools that we've already done? Let's look at the wine data set. The next data set we covered briefly. We didn't cover this much, this one in as much depth as we covered wines. It's a combination of things, but fundamentally what's happening is, and in fact, decision trees are, by their nature, very susceptible to overfitting. The reason why decision trees are susceptible to overfitting is that each time I'm taking a branch, every time I'm making a decision, I can't really unmake that decision, right? So if I make a wrong decision here, then I sort of end up going down the wrong path. And sometimes when we overfit, sometimes you get these very, very complex trees that have very, very complex rules. Maybe if I sort of show it. You know, in the case of logistic regression, you can think of a tree, or at least comparing it to logistic regression, you can consider a tree as being much like logistic regression in the sense that it defines a decision boundary. So I guess in this case there's only categorical variables, but so I have I have a split here for male, female, and then I have a split here for class. This is an upper class. Right, and so as I go down, basically where I'm ending up here is an outcome of my decision tree. And so if I'm, you know, the first split is going to determine whether I'm on the left half or the right half, and same thing for class. So as I make more and more complex trees, what ends up happening is that I get something that sort of starts to look like a Picasso drawing. I get something like this, and then I get something like this. And decision trees, because they can only, every split that I make is axis aligned. I can't have, you know, any split that doesn't fit vertically or horizontally. And so as I start building out, start making it more complex trees, and I said start, you know, introducing more leaves and more complex in the tree, I end up getting something that just like with logistic regression, doesn't model reality. It starts looking like this boring sort of abstract art. And so that's more or less, you know, at a high level why decision trees overfit. It's a very similar principle. And in fact, they're more susceptible for overfitting because I can only fit along these lines, you know, oftentimes I'll, if I'm not careful, if I don't apply decision trees carefully, I can introduce like a channel or like a split that misclassifies out of sample data. Let's paste the whole. I'm gonna paste this whole thing in and just sort of break it apart and go from there. So feature scaling is also a critical concept. Why do we scale features? Well, some of our models are susceptible to feature scaling, or some of them are more susceptible to feature scaling than others. Some don't require it at all. When we're doing distance-based modeling like k-nearest neighbors, how we define a distance metric is going to have an impact on the performance of our model, right? Because the concept of nearest neighbors, the whole concept of nearest neighbors, the whole premise of nearest neighbors is that nearest implies some sort of distance. And oftentimes we define distance in the classical sense, Euclidean distance, the difference from mi to kiva. There's also the first norm, which is Manhattan distance, so it's you can think of it like the number of blocks. If I'm walking to, you know, Times Square from here, it would be 20 blocks north or 10 blocks west, whatever. So when we have distance-based metrics, we need to sort of make sure that our features, you know, if they're distributed over a different range of distance, we sort of have to make sure we're comparing apples to apples. And so one way of doing that is with standard scaling. And so I'll build up a data frame from scratch, just to sort of show proof of principle how this works. Right, so I'm not using anything with scikit-learn, nothing fancy like that. And I mentioned before that really a data frame fundamentally is just an array of values. It's basically an array of, each row is a hash, basically. And so I'm defining for each variable my column, I have column A, B, C, that has the following values. Out of sample, again, has the same format, but there's only one sample for out of sample. And so we'll define a very, very simple data set like so.
And just for the heck of it, let's do a scatter plot on this, just so you can sort of see what the data looks like. Scatter matrix. I need to do matplotlib inline. I'm in a new IPython notebook, by the way. You don't have to be, but. Import pandas as pd. Import. Okay, I guess it's sort of hard to see. I'll show it in a bit. So I'm declaring a k-neighbors classifier just with one neighbor, fitting x and y. And then I'm going to do the exact same thing with a standard scalar. Let's do this in two separate steps. And I'll print this. So the first time, it predicts 1. So let's see. We have... We have a series of points, and so it's finding the nearest neighbor for this one point. Not sure which one it is. So our label data here, right? So I think it's our label data here. Our scales are very, very different. So we have a scale of 0 to 2. A, B, and C have completely different scales. So fundamentally, the nearest neighbor is going to be very, very different, depending on whether or not we apply standard scaling. And so let's scale the data. Standard scaler. Am I missing? I may be missing a point. Anyhow, I'm scaling the data with standard scaler, and I'm just applying a fit and a transform. So now when I look at x scaled, I'll just print these. X scaled. This is pretty basic. So again, the original x values are obviously spread over much wider data set. But what's interesting is that we'll sort of clarify this. I guess it's hard to sort of separate. Print x values. Print x scaled. Right, so the proportions here are the same. So, but it's basically sort of reshaped and brought down my distances, normalized them all to be within sort of a uniform space. Okay, so I want you guys to apply the same. This is actually much more interesting on a real data set than it is on a few sample values. So I'm going to post this little tidbit on Slack in case some of you haven't gotten the... Not yet. So you'll need to obviously import pandas and matplotlib. But why don't you guys will go through this next example and tell me what you see, tell me what you get for the different scores. So you'll need to sort of, I guess, sort of break this out, break it into separate pieces, and let's see. We should see two different scores, and let's see the difference between them. Let's give it. This shouldn't take too long. I think 5 minutes should be plenty. So in 5 minutes, I guess we'll. 5 minutes, we'll go through it. Who has the answer? Anyone have the answer yet? So Thielman, what did you get for your Kanin scores on the scaled and unscaled data? Anyone have it? You guys are able to run the examples, right? Okay, so I guess I'll go through mine quickly. So really, the only thing that should have needed to be changed is just an explicit print on the KNN score on the X train and Y train. So there's really two data sets. There's the training data that's unscaled, and then there's this training scale that's training data that's scaled using a standard scaler. And the difference between the two is significant. The AUC score is 64.4 on the unscaled data, and it is 86.6% on the scaled data. So a difference of about 22 1/3%. So yeah, this is a very meaningful difference between them. Also, so we've talked about grid search, talked about cross-validation, talked about standard scaler. Another useful tool is pipeline. And just simply applying a sequence of transformations. So typically what we've been doing is we've been applying steps like standard scalar 1-1, feature selection. And then model. More or less, pipelining just allows us to sort of think of these as a sequence of events which are a single entity. And this is useful for automation, right? So we're deploying this to a server or something like that. You know, there might be, we might want to combine, we might want to sort of reuse scikit-learn's transform steps, feature selection steps, modeling steps, and so we can sort of mix and compose and construct more complex processing tools by using this pipelining approach. So an example of how to do that, we'll use a very simple, in the wine data set, we'll just use grid search to do that. So we can use this in conjunction with grid search, with all the tools. This is fully compatible with all of the models, all the tools we've used so far. So put this in here as well, grid search. I guess grid search would go. We can also modify if we want to, supply grid search in here. We can just simply add it to the pipeline. So it's a collection of a series, a sequence of independent transformations, which in conjunction sort of form a larger transformation. Okay, so grid search. And so I've basically, let's break this down into steps. Again, same data set, wine data set. And we're just taking cross-validation score. And right off the bat, our cross-validation score is 0.72. So let's keep that in mind. And then maybe if we scale, how does scaling do? Well, scaling has a huge impact. Why do you think scaling, I mean, why does scaling have such a large impact? More specifically, let's look at the original data set, right? So what do you think, David?
Why the scaling is important?
Yeah. Yeah, there's a huge, it's pretty clear, pretty obvious why. Proline and color, what happens is when I'm doing k-nearest neighbors and I have one value that's in the thousands and one value that's in the single digits, you know, there's going to be huge performance difference between them. So, again, just another example of that. Distance-based metrics are sensitive to. So anything that's using distance as a function of some other, that's using scoring or evaluation as a function of distance. KNN is using distance. Clustering can also be sensitive to it. Linear regression can be not sensitive to it from an evaluation standpoint or an accuracy standpoint, but sometimes some algorithms will be faster on normalized data, standard scale data. So like regression is oftentimes faster on standard scale data. Well, it's an extra step and you'd have to transform it back. So in general, no, there's some loss of machine precision, you know, because there's gonna be a little bit of rounding error, but in most cases that will make a difference. So we make a pipeline here. Again, we're applying this in two steps. We're doing standard scaling and we're doing the classifier with the neighbors of three. So we're getting a mean value of about 90 for our AUC score. And then again, same thing, we just apply grid search CV. Oh, by the way, an important note is that order of operations can matter. When you scale data, so k-nearest neighbors, sometimes scikit-learn will scale the data internally, and so if you put it in a pipeline, it'll yield a bit of inaccuracy. So, you know, they're more or less the same, but there's a small amount of error here because of the way scikit-learn handles it internally. Just something to keep in mind. It's particularly sensitive, I guess. When you have to watch out for it is with the k-neighbors classifier and also the clustering algorithm. Sometimes you'll see that, some sensitivity, some inaccuracy here based on when and how you apply it. And also, just sort of elaborate on that point, when we cross-validate, order of operations in which we splice the data to cross-validate. You know, so let's say I have collection of numbers. So this has a pair of 3, 4, 7, 9, 18, 20. And let's say I split this into two pieces.
So standard scalar, the order of operations are, do I split first and then do standard scalar, or do I do standard scalar first and then do the cross-validation? And one thing that you have to be careful for is that you make sure that you put this in the asterisk, because it's very important. Ensure cross-validation, ensure scaling before split. Right? Because if I split the data set, my bounds are now different.
My data set, what's proposed by data set is different, right?
So the average here. So in other words, if I take the average, when I take a chunk, right, the scaling is going to be different for this than it is going to be for this. And so it will apply that scaling differently. It can yield unexpected results. In this case, the difference isn't very dramatic, but.
Sorry, can you just repeat that? Less like there. I'm just trying to understand. Like,
maybe it's better if I represent it as a plot, right? So, standard scaling isn't what you call a. I don't believe it's the standard deviation aspect of the. It's not a linear transformation. In other words, let's say I have two sort of separate sections, two separate sections of data. Say I have a series of points here, and here, right? And one point here, and one point here. And so maybe the mean is here for this. I just looked at this group, and maybe the standard deviation here. So we'll call this sort of group A. And we'll call this, I guess, group B. And so group B has a smaller standard deviation, right? But so when I do the normalization, and let's say I also have, I guess, A and B. So say A and B is all six of these points, right? So if I do, so I have sort of three entities, I have A and B. And my question to you is the standard deviation of A and B and the standard deviation of A and the standard deviation of equal to, I guess, is it equal to the standard deviation of A plus the standard deviation of B? Remember, standard normalization is dividing, it's subtracting the mean and dividing by the standard deviation. And so because the answer here is no. And the reason why the answer is no is because of this. If I look at standard deviation, it's something like x minus, remember, this is x minus x mean squared, minus 1. It's this squared value here that causes it to be nonlinear. In other words, it's sort of outside, the mathematics and the proof of this are sort of outside the scope of this course. Suffice to say that when I standard scale group A independently and group B independently, I'll get a different result than if I take the entire group of them together, the whole group, and do standard scaling to the entire data set.
And it's because of this property, this nonlinear property of the standard deviation, having this square value here. So one way around that is that we sort of package it together and we apply them in the same step. And so we do this make pipeline. And you know, functionally, the difference isn't too dramatic, but there is a difference between them. And actually, I mean, it's moreover that this is the correct answer, because this is the correct transformation of steps. This is an erroneous result here. Okay, so this is a good stopping point. We'll finish the last part of this sort of Python code in the first bit of next class. And we'll also be moving on eventually to scaling data and databases. In that interest, you have all seen, or I guess I know Aaron sent a picture of this on. Sent a picture of this on Slack. This is a useful heuristic. It's sort of a roadmap, a guide to scikit-learn in most of its core algorithms and when you apply which. And it's very, very powerful. It's very, very useful. I guess caution that it's not the word of God, and that it's not, if you don't bind yourself too closely to always think about what you're doing before you're going to do it. The rules here are not necessarily absolutes. They're best practices. And there's oftentimes big differences between absolutes and best practices. So a lot of this stuff we've seen.
SVC and ensemble classifiers. SVC are support vector machines, k-neighbors. So really fundamentally, we've touched all of the core aspects of scikit-learn. And so you can imagine that if I have a data set, I can apply a set of rules, I apply a set of heuristics, and really, you know, I guess oftentimes get a reasonable result. My caveat, I would say, the caveat is that when you blindly apply rules like this to a data set, when you just go sort of like almost like through like a laundry list or sort of like a procedural method of taking an approach to data science, oftentimes you lose sight of the objective at hand. And so, you know, while tools like this are undoubtedly useful, don't rely on them too heavily. Always rely on your intuition. Always, above all else, always, you know, make sure that you're asking the right questions and that the steps you're making are reasonable to achieve the objective you're looking for. We covered a lot this lecture. Most of it was review. Not all of it, but most of it was review. Hopefully it was useful. Are there any final questions before we adjourn? Nothing? Okay, well, hopefully there'll be questions on Thursday. I guess I'll finish by saying that I realize that the stuff is tremendously overwhelming. It's overwhelming to all of us. That's what makes it interesting and exciting. So, you know, keep that curiosity, take your curiosity at heart, and really, it's an incredibly interesting field because there's such a broad array of academic pursuits, business pursuits, practical pursuits. It's tremendously exciting and interesting field to be in, mostly because of its complexity and because there aren't really hard and fast rules. This isn't like front-end web development or, you know, mobile web development was, you know, procedural rules to get from point A to point Z.
And oftentimes you'll think that there's a path from point A to point Z, and maybe there is, maybe there isn't. But really, you'll want to make sure that you know how to apply cross-validation rules, you know how to apply these pre-processing rules, know how to effectively utilize the tools that we've covered in this class to get you from point A to point Z, or in the case that, you know, there isn't a clear path from point A to point Z, know where there are holes, know where there are issues, and making sure that you have visibility and ownership over the data that you're working on. And I also want to emphasize that the name of this class is Intro to Data Science, not Intro to Scikit-Learn. Scikit-Learn is incredibly successful because it's well-designed and it's comprehensive, reasonably comprehensive in its tool set, and it's easy to use and it's easy to get good results relatively quickly. So I urge you not to emphasize or to put too much focus too much on the implementation details of Scikit-Learn. Always keep an eye out on the larger picture of, again, what the objective is and really what these each of these tools are doing, right? So what is, when would you, what's the difference between support vector machines, linear regression, decision trees, etc. You know, what, how does cross-validation work? Because you'll, if you go to other tool sets like Spark and R, you'll see patterns. You'll sort of see things like regularization parameters. So understand what a regularization parameter is. Don't remember that high C is good or low C is bad or whatever. Really look at the larger picture outside of Scikit-Learn. In any case, I guess that leaves us with about enough time for you guys to finish your exit tickets, and I will see you on Thursday. Is there a new what? Yeah, it's called Spark.
Okay. Yeah, I've heard of that. So if you're going to apply this to like an
I mean, the short answer is there isn't any specific, there's a suite of methods that people are applying. Chief among them, I mean, really random forests and ensemble learning methods are extremely powerful and flexible. So if there's one tool that we've learned so far that's probably been used and you see being used a lot, that are sort of, you see a lot on competitions, or winning competitions, it's the random forests. And ensembles, more and more generally ensembles. Ensembles are all the rage these days. Towards your, I think your the first part of your question, are there tools outside of Scikit-Learn that are interesting, or are there, and the answer is yeah, there's a lot. You've probably heard of Hadoop, and you've probably heard of all of the sort of sub-projects that Hadoop has spawned, and specifically within that there's Spark. It's still sort of a nascent project. There's still a lot of development being done, but the benefit with Spark is that it's more performant than Scikit-Learn, and it's more amenable to be deployed in a production system than Scikit-Learn. So Scikit-Learn is good for exploration. It doesn't scale as well to massive data sets, and so Spark is attempting to solve that problem. We won't go into Spark in depth. We will talk about it sort of in the next phase of this class. So there'll be plenty of time for that, but yeah, I would definitely look into Spark if you're looking into really where there's potential. Yeah, if you look at the Spark documentation, there are a lot of these. Like there's, and almost I guess what you'll see in almost every machine learning library worth its name is you'll see linear regression, you'll see logistic regression. And oftentimes, I'd say like those two are really like the fundamental ones. Sometimes you'll see decision trees. Really everything we've covered so far are things that are standard in any sort of machine learning toolkit. But one thing you'll see time and time again is cross-validation, the cross-validation tools, input transformations, and really logistic and linear regression, because you can get very, very far on linear and logistic regression alone.